But in reality, we're going to look at Christmas in the book of Hebrews. We're going to spend Christmas in the book of Hebrews. And this may be not exactly what people are accustomed to. Sometimes we go to Luke. Sometimes we go to Matthew's account. I like Galatians chapter 4, if you ask me. A great Christmas message, verse. It's in Galatians chapter 4. But this week and next week, we're going to see Christmas in the book of Hebrews. And why the book of Hebrews is because there's so much of Jesus, and especially in the first two, three chapters. The whole thing is it's about the Lord. But how the writer of Hebrews describes and gives us the account of Jesus as being supreme over everything, it'll make sense why I believe this message, this book has so much for our Christian society today. Because this was written to Christians. This was written to believers in the first century. And so much of what they went through or what they're going through leads us to believe it's very similar to our culture and society. So let's read with me first the first five verses of chapter 1, Hebrews chapter 1, 1 through 5. In times past, long ago, God spoke to the fathers by the prophets, at different times and in different ways. But in the last days, in these last days, he's spoken to us through his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom he made the universe. He is the express image of his glory, the radiance of his glory, and the exact expression or image of his nature. He sustains all things by the word of his power, by his powerful word. After making atonement for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, so he became higher in rank than angels, just as the name he inherited is superior to theirs. For to which of the angels did he ever say, "You are my son, today I have begotten you, I will become your father," or again, "I will be his father, and he will be my son"? Lord, thank you for your word. Make it real to us, Jesus. Lord, we don't want to just hear it, Lord. We want to live it out and know it intimately, what it means to follow you, Lord, what it means to be a Christian, what it means to have Jesus as the Lord and Savior. Lord, in our society, that name, and it's so misused and maligned, the word Christian. We don't even know what it means anymore because everyone has that title or name, and but they don't live in accordance to how you live, in accordance to your word. Lord Jesus, please help us to understand who Jesus is today more than when we walked in. And Lord, if according to your word, you are, Lord God, supreme God, Lord, that we should leave this place in worship and in adoration of you, and our lives should be changed, and our world should be changed because we worship someone much greater than anything we'll ever know. In Jesus' name, amen. There's a story of the Wright brothers. You know who the Wright brothers are? The guys who airplane, okay? And there's a story of the Wright brothers. When they flew for the first time in 1903, they send a telegraph to their sister, Catherine. And they send it to her, and there was a telegraph, and it basically said, "We flew 120 feet. Great, great. And we'll be home for Christmas." That's all it said. And she was so excited, she ran to the editor, the newspaper editor at the time, and she ran to the editor and said, "Look, you know, my brothers flew." And or she showed him the message. And the editor looked at it and said, "Oh, the boys will be home for Christmas. How nice." Totally missed the fact that they flew 120 feet. And for the first time mankind flew, totally missed. Because he just read, "They'll be home for Christmas." And so many times, I think, in our day and age in which we live, in our culture in which we live, with the holidays, everything coming into the last few weeks of December and obviously November as well, we tend to look at those things more than the fact of why we're even doing such things. Now, as Christians, we know and understand that the proclamation of the Lord's coming, his first coming, should be proclaimed at any time throughout the year. September 1st, through March 14th to September 25th to February 11th. It doesn't matter what day we proclaim the Lord, that he came, that he died, that he rose again. That's our proclamation. That is the gospel, that he's coming back. It doesn't matter what day it is. Obviously, in our culture and society, in December, we tend to have an emphasis. Our culture actually acknowledges it, that Jesus actually came. It's a baby in a manger. The stores are filled. The holidays are here. Poinsettias are here. And, there's a tendency in our society to actually acknowledge that such a person exists. Without the ACLU breathing down your back, that it might sue you. You could actually acknowledge it, that you could say Merry Christmas, at least for now. And isn't it interesting that is very much part of our very much our society, that no matter, every year we do the same thing. Every year we go through the holidays, the decorations, the lights, but do we look a step back and say, hey, what exactly is our society celebrating? And the reason why I say that is because the book of Hebrews is written to a generation of Christians, second or third generation Christians, Jewish believers, who, as parents and grandparents that they had, were being tempted to fall back and tempted to not understand Jesus. Because they didn't understand Jesus, tempted to go back under the law, to the temple worship, to the sacrificial system of the Old Testament. And they were tempted to go back because they didn't know or didn't understand who Jesus really was or who Jesus really is. And so they made all these compromises, and they fell away and they fell back. And the temptation was to go to be part of the Old Covenant, the Old Covenant worship with the temple, with the sacrifices, with the priest, and never understood that they lived in the New Testament, in the New Testament age. And their parents or grandparents who had become believers had taught them this, but now they were at a cross point. They were at a cross point to really follow the Lord or go back under the law, to go back under the cultural, societal norms of the day. In many ways, I think our society is in the very same token. We have lived in, America has been not necessarily a Christian nation for most of its time, but we have the heritage. We have believers in America. We've had grandparents who were believers. How many of you guys here had parents and grandparents who were believers? All right, majority of you, maybe. And then we're second generation, or maybe third generation. Every generation is accountable to be born again. Every generation has to be born again. Can't rely on the faith of your parents, can't rely on the faith of our grandparents. That's a given. We all have to be regenerated, every single one of us, no matter if we had grandparents that were Christians or not. However, those who came from a godly line, a godly lineage, a heritage, the tendency is to not know the Lord as well as we did, as well as our grandparents did, as well as our parents did, and to take it for granted that which we grew up with. There's a tendency to, because we know it so well, we tend to not be involved as much. I know that believers, children of believers, have that tendency. And by the grace of God, some of you guys have overcome that. But there's a tendency among children or grandchildren of believers to become compromised in their faith. Why? Because each generation has to be regenerated. Each generation has to be renewed. And the early Christians began to look at the Bible. They began to look at the Old Testament and they say, hey, we're Jews. We should be as Jews. We should live as Jews. But wait a minute, we're Christians. The Messiah has come. And they said that they saw the temple. They saw the sacrificial system. And they thought, well, can we just be part of that? Can we just go back under those things? In the book of Hebrews, the writer says, don't go back. Don't go back to a bankrupt system, because you may never come back. That was the warning. You may never come back. Don't compromise the person of Jesus. Don't compromise his sacrifice. Don't compromise the fact that he is our high priest. The warning is there. What's the warning for America today on Christmas message? Is the fact that we have a generation, many generations of believers. And now that our kids or our grandkids are around. The tendency is to live in a society where the exclusivity of Jesus is downplayed. We live in a society where Jesus is one of many choices, one of many in the pantheon of gods. He's not the only way. He's one of many ways. Just pick one. Just pick the way. Hey, it worked for your grandparents. It worked for your mom. It worked for your dad. It may not work for you. And that is the society in which we live in, society that it's inclusive. And a message of Jesus that's exclusive. It's only him, through him. Our kids, our grandkids, are going to face those pressures to compromise in an age in which everything is it's a go. If it feels good, just do it. If it's a God that you like, it may not be the God of your parents, but hey, it's your God, it's your way. And it includes all faith. It includes all valid religion. All religions are valid. That's the age in which we live in. That's the age which our kids face. That's the age in which our grandkids face. And are they going to stand in that age and say, no, it's the exclusivity of Jesus that we must follow. It's the supremacy of Christ that's important. Well, with the pressures that the early church had, many of the believers, the Jewish believers at the time of the book of Hebrews, as it was written, were going back to the temple. They were participating in temple worship and the sacrifices and the high priest. And the book of Hebrews says, no, what are you doing? Come back to Jesus. Come back to who he is. Not come back to who you think he is. Come back to who he really is. And don't get him amalgamated. Don't amalgamate him. Don't wrap him up in all the other religious stuff that you get involved in. And boy, in our society, we have a lot of religious stuff. Very religious. And we tend to bunch up Jesus with all the other stuff that we do in our holidays, in our seasons, in our lights, in our everything that we do. We tend to bunch him up and say, well, he's just part of the culture. And our kids are the ones who are going to face those pressures. Unless they are regenerated, unless they're born again, unless they understand the supremacy of Jesus, it's going to be like the book of Hebrews. And so let's get into the book of Hebrews. Grab a hot chocolate. Grab your marshmallows. Grab what you get for Christmas, you know. Chestnuts roasting on an open fire. And let's spend time in the book of Hebrews. Let's spend Christmas in the book of Hebrews. Today and next week. Let's go to the first slide. The book of Hebrews is such a fascinating thing. The early Christians didn't really celebrate Christmas. They called it the nativity. And it was basically the understanding that Jesus as God had come into the world. We don't have recorded when his birth was. We don't know when his birth was. We don't know what date he was born. Sorry to burst the bubble on a lot of people. It just we don't know. Nobody with a Jewish understanding of the New Testament would look at it and say it was December 25th. No shepherd would have been out on the field in December in Israel. Probably would have been August or September, our best guess. But we don't know because his first coming is like his second coming. We don't know his second coming. We don't know the date of his first coming either. It's made that way so we can always proclaim his coming or his return, never a date. Never a date. Because we don't become ready by knowing a date. We become ready by living a life that is committed to Christ. That's how we get ready. It's living a holy life. It's living for the Lord. That's how we get ready, not by a date. So God never gave us a date of the first. Didn't give us a date for the second one. I find that very odd. Yet the Christians proclaim Jesus to be God in human flesh, to come into this world, and they proclaim the nativity. And so as time went on, it sort of got into, and we'll get all the other details, how it got up to December 25th. But we ended up with December 25th as a date. Next slide. The book of Hebrews tells us something about this very real thing. Next slide. That's the Wright brothers, if you wanted to see a picture of them. That Jesus is better than everything that you're going to celebrate in your whole life. If you're going to celebrate something, celebrate Jesus. Because he's better than anything you will ever celebrate. And that's a big statement in our society where, well, what about Ramadan? And what about this holiday? And what about that? Everybody needs the holiday. Every religion should be appointed a time because all religions are the same. That's the exclusivity of Jesus, by the way. That's exclusive. He is far above, greater than anything. And that can get us into a lot of trouble in our society because it's very much geared to everybody's equal. All religions are the same. No, not all religions are the same. There's one supreme above all, and that is Jesus. Now, our kids need to understand that, but our kids not only understand it, they need to be regenerated by that truth. Need to live by that truth, need to know the truth, and need to be stand up for the truth of that. Because it's becoming very, very real in our day and age that that exclusivity of Jesus, it's not tolerated at all. And so Christmas becomes amalgamated with everything else. But the book of Hebrews says he's better than anything else. He's better than anything we have. Fill in the blank. The book of Hebrews was written to right around 64, 65 AD. We know that because the war between Rome and the Jews started around 67 AD. No Jew would have traveled, no one would have traveled to that area of Jerusalem at the time of 67 AD. It was destroyed in 70 AD. And the book of Hebrews tells us, the writer tells us, that he is going to come and visit them. So we know that we're dealing with sometime before the destruction of the temple, and then before 67 AD. Best guess, 64, 65 AD. Written to Christians. Second, third generation of Christians who had grandparents, who had parents, who might not even be saved by the ministry of Jesus. They were there that long. They were around at the time of Jesus. They were there. Now they had kids. Now they had grandkids. And the temptation to go back under the law was there. It was very real. And you think of the compromise. You think of the compromise that you see in the church today. You see great men of God. And I've talked to many pastors, many godly pastors who say, yeah, you know, I have four kids or five kids, whatever it may be. Two are walking with the Lord, three are not. Or three are walking with the Lord and two are not. And I have 10 grandkids, they say, and five are walking with the Lord and five are not. How is that? Well, the book of Hebrews is like that. It's written to those Christians, second, third generation Christians, grandkids or kids, who needed to go back to the Word of God and say, look what you have. Look at the heritage that you have and trust in Jesus and put him ahead of everything that you do, culturally, socially, holiday-wise. Now, the temple was still standing. The temple was still standing, and they could see the temple. They could see the sacrifices. They could see the high priest, and the tendency was, well, we see the guy, the high priest, can we just go back, and it's a lot easier. They were being persecuted for their faith. They were being not tolerated in the society, and it was a lot easier because Judaism was still tolerated, and Christianity was not tolerated. So it was easier to be a Jew under the Romans at the time than to be a Christian. And so the tendency was, well, I'm a Jew. I can go back under that system, and it'll be a lot. My life will be a lot easier. When you think about it today, wouldn't life be easier, do you think? I'm sure people in the persecuted countries, life will be a lot easier if they would deny their faith and do what those oppressors would say. But they're not. They're standing for their faith. And this is what the Hebrew Christians were dealing with. They had to stand up for their faith, and at some point in America, we need to stand up for our faith. We do. We need. It's coming very, very fast. The exclusivity of Jesus is eroding very fast. It's not tolerated. In fact, even Jesus, the name Jesus is not tolerated at all. And to say that he's the greatest, to say that he's greater than Muhammad could get me in jail in Canada or in Europe. To say that the Bible is superior to the Quran, it could be an ACLU lawsuit right there. That's the age in which we live. Isn't it easier to say, well, yeah, Muhammad and Jesus, we can combine the two. It's called Chrislam. We can kind of deal with it, and it makes it a lot easier for me. Now, I may know that, and I may teach that, and I may stand firm in that, but will my kids? And if God gives me more years, will my grandkids? Oh, Grandpa was nuts. He was too fanatical. Too crazy. Come on. I think my kids think of it sometimes. Oh, my dad. He just talks and talks and talks all day. And but, you know, but okay, I talk all day, but do you know what I'm saying? And do you know why I talk all day? Because there's not enough time to just be quiet. It's not time to be quiet. It's time to stand up for the truth, to stand up for God's word, because the Hebrew Christians were dealing with that, and the writer makes it very clear. Don't compromise. Don't go back under the society pressure. You have a heritage. Your grandparents were Christians. Your parents were Christians. Don't you know why they were Christians? Because of Jesus. And if you compromise on Jesus, you compromise on his work on the cross, you compromise on what he did for you and washed you from your sins, and you go back under that temple, the danger is you may not come back. Oh, come on, really? That's what the book of Hebrews says. Now, the writer of Hebrews, we're not going to go into all the details, good evidence that it was Paul, good evidence that it was Paul the Apostle. We'll leave it at that. I don't know who he was. But whoever it was a good friend of Timothy. He knew Timothy really well. And he loved the Jewish people quite a bit. So much so that if it is Paul, I'm not sure, but if it is Paul, Paul wrote that he would love to save the Jewish people. And that he was willing to go to hell. Willing to go to hell so they would be going to heaven. Romans 9 tells us. So if it is Paul, it's a good evidence that it is. He is a good candidate to write such a letter of fervency, of desire for them not to go back under the law and to now enjoy the newness of Jesus Christ. Now, next slide. The Jewish believers, whenever there's a move of the Holy Spirit, people get regenerated. Amen? That's what happens. That's how you got saved. Whenever there's a move of the Holy Spirit, people get saved. But then there's that second generation. And then that third generation that needs to be regenerated. And that's the trouble that they had. They're being challenged to stay in the faith. And the question to the writer of Hebrews is, from the writer of Hebrews is, are you in the faith or are you not in the faith? Are you going back to the temple or are you staying with Jesus? Now, I got to remind you this. When Jesus died on the cross, he said, it is finished. The telestai. It is finished. In the temple, the veil that separated the holy place to the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant was rent, was torn from the top to the bottom. And don't think of a little veil that you see, a little flimsy veil, was 6.5 inches thick. This veil was no joke. It was a big, thick veil. It was rent. It was ripped from the top to the bottom. And you can literally see into the Holy of Holies. No one's ever seen it, except the high priest who goes it once a year. But now it was torn. It was open. So there was no barricade between man and God. Man can go to God through Jesus. That's what that meant. It was torn. It was open. People could see it. And you can go to the Holy of Holies. There was no obstacle anymore. God has made a way for us to go to him through Jesus. He said, it is finished. According to God, the temple worship and sacrifices was unnecessary anymore. There was no need for animal sacrifices. There was no need for a high priest. There was no need for anything in the temple. It was completely done away with. But it lived, or it continued, for 40 years. 40 years later was when it was destroyed by the Romans. So for 40 years, it continued. Same sacrifices, the same thing, the animals, the high priest, the blood, all that stuff. And you could see a Jewish believer going, I know we're told that Jesus is the way. I know we're told that Jesus is exclusive. I know that he is the Messiah, the coming one, that he is the perfect sacrifice. But boy, that looks really interesting. That heritage, that Old Testament, man loves religion. They see it and they go, they do this and do that. And I would be part of it and see the high priest. And, oh, that's so good. And look, if I go to the synagogue, they're not going to persecute me. Sounds like a good deal. I can kind of be hush-hush about it and go into there and kind of be cool and everything's fine and the heat's not going to be on me. And the writer of Hebrews is pleading with them. Don't go back to the Judaizing of your faith. Stay with Jesus. The idea was that if Jesus was not supreme God, if he was not who they claim he was, then he was much lower in their eyes, Jesus had downgraded, because that's what they were doing. They were downgrading Jesus in his work on the cross. It's interesting, one of the first heresies in the early church was that Jesus was not God. It's one of the first ones. Jesus was not God. And there was a group of Christians, Jewish Christians, you would say. They're called the Ebionites, and they lived in northern Africa. And they were Jews who believed in Jesus. But they believed that Jesus was Messiah only. He wasn't God. They believed he was the Messiah, but they believed he was not God. And so they looked at the letters of Paul, and they threw them out, and they only accepted the Jewish, what they considered the Jewish books. No Gentile book they allowed. And they were very influential in northern Africa, the Ebionites. But that was one of different groups who believed that Jesus was a man, maybe a good man, a good moral man, a good anointed man, perhaps, but not God himself. We're not going to go that far, they would say. He's good, he's a teacher, he's anointed, but not God. And they would leave it at that, and they would worship God and thank Jesus, but never worship Jesus as God. Those are early heresies, and this is what this book really deals with. Now, he begins to explain a few things, and let's go to chapter 1 now. Talk long enough about the intro. The supremacy of Christ. Let's go to the next slide. The supremacy of Christ. Long ago, God spoke to the fathers by the prophets. First thing he deals with is their heritage, their lineage. Look, you have an Old Testament. But do you realize that the Old Testament has no meaning unless Jesus is God? There's no Jews here, otherwise they would have walked out. Right? That is inflammatory. But that's what the book of Hebrews is saying. The Old Testament has no meaning unless Jesus Christ is God. Why? Because he says he spoke to us by the prophets. Yes, amen. All the prophets of the Old Testament. What did they say? They foretold of a man who would be coming to earth. He would be anointed by God, a servant of God, and he would die. He would be sacrificed. He would be one who proclaimed the righteousness of God. And the prophets set up the stage, right? They set up the Old Testament. It's setting up the stage for the Messiah to come, and he would come. But if the stage is, it's nothing. It's empty unless the hero comes to the picture, right? The stage is nothing unless there is a hero, unless there's the main actor in the picture. And that's what he's saying. Look, the prophets set it up. It's perfect. It's good. Nothing wrong with it unless there's Jesus, unless he's God, unless he fulfills it all, then it's empty. It's hollow. It means nothing. Now, he's not saying forget the Old Testament. He's saying, look, he came to fulfill the Old Testament. He spoke by the prophets, but in the last days, he spoke to us by his Son. That means Jesus is the living revelation of God. He's the ultimate revelation of God. That's what we call it, the supremacy of Christ. Why? He's supreme. Supreme means he's above it all. Preeminent. He is above all the revelations of the Old Testament, meaning that without him, it means nothing. You can't, truly, can you make sense of some of these Old Testament accounts without Jesus? I mean, you look at it and you go, how does this make sense unless there's a fulfillment in a Messiah? If you read the last book of in our Bible, the book of Malachi, it says that God will bring a curse upon the earth. Listen, strike the earth with a curse. And that's the end. Thank you. Good night. Well, what kind of a hope is that in the book of Malachi? Now, in the book, in the Jewish Bible, it's 2 Chronicles, the last book. And it ends with the destruction of Jerusalem. And Zedekiah has his eyes gouged out, and they go into captivity. That's even more comforting. What's the point of that? You realize it makes no absolute sense. Unless that which the prophets proclaimed, it was about a Messiah who would come. But this was no ordinary Messiah, not just an anointed man. He was God himself as a man. And this is the point of Hebrews. If he was just a mere prophet, then you can lump him in with Isaiah, with Jeremiah. The Muslims claim that he is another prophet like Muhammad. He's lesser than Muhammad, but another prophet. You can lump him in with everybody. But if he's greater than that, then we have an accountability to live for him. We have an accountability to worship him. And if he's greater than the prophets, then why are you going back to the temple? And to Christians in our day and age, if he's greater than anything, why do we relegate him only to Christmas? For Easter. Why do we relegate him to only once a week? Why do we only relegate him to once a week and not every day of our lives? Not a worship of Jesus every day. Why? Because, is it because we don't truly believe he's supreme? Well, let's keep going. He's greater than everything. In the last days, he spoke to us by his son. He is the heir of all things, who also through whom he also made the universe. See, our society, we're funneled into that Jesus can't be God. Can't be the only way. There's a lot of people that say that. Oprah likes to say that. He can't be the only way. Well, that's it. Oprah said it, so that must be. That's it. That's the finality of everything. She said it. It can't be true. Because the idea is that, look, you can't have it like that. Mankind is opposed to that. Why? Because they just cannot imagine an exclusive way to God. Can you imagine? I mean, that's what the Bible proclaims, that there's only one way. And you can't have it your way. It has to be his way. And we huff and puff, and I can't believe it. And mankind, you know, puts his fist at God, because how can it be one way? Honestly, how can it be one way? God has to be much more open to that. Nope, he says, it's exclusive through my son, whom he made heir of all things, and he made the world. Through him, he made the world. Now, this is an amazing fact. He is the creator of the world. How is he the creator? Well, let's go to Genesis 1:1 really quickly. Genesis 1:1. By the way, this is very interesting. When we read Genesis 1, when we read Genesis 1 and 2, almost to Genesis 2, from verse 1, to when man is created, a lot of times people tune out. A lot of people tune out when we read Genesis 1:1. It's just, you know, talking about God, Genesis 1:1, all the way up to where man is created, people tune out. And then man is created, and then people tune back in. Why is that? You know, sometimes we just can't relegate the fact that God existed before us. Huh? There's somebody greater than me? There's somebody greater than humanity? Yeah. He existed before humanity started. And yet Genesis 1:1 tells us this. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and empty. Darkness covered the surface of the water and the depths, and the Spirit of God hovered over the surface of the water. And then God said, he created everything through the word of his power. God said, and it happened. It was through his word that God created everything. Now, in the Bible, it tells us this unique sense of the Word of God. It's a title for Jesus. It's a title for Christ. He's the only one who has it. The Word of God. In fact, when you read Revelation, the last book in the Bible, when Jesus comes back, he still has that title. What does it say? His name is called the Word of God. Revelation 19. When he comes back triumphantly, he is still called the Word of God. When God spoke, it was through Jesus, the Word, that he created everything. Now, John 1:1 explains it much more detail. Go to John 1:1. Great verse to witness to people, but there's so much depth in that. John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were created through him, the Word. And apart from him, not one thing was created that has been created. The word, the logos, we would say, the logos in Greek, logos. The Greek had an idea of logos. So when John's writing this, the Greeks had an idea of that word, logos, which we translated word. It means much, much more than just a spoken word. The idea of logos, according to the Greeks, was it was a unique being, a unique spiritual being, whom God revealed himself to men, whom you can have a relationship with God, whom God created everything through this logos, but then John throws in the wrench. He says the logos became flesh, became a living person, a man of flesh. And the Greeks would have gone, no way, because the logos is so holy that he cannot take on human form. He's separated. We can go to him, but he's separated from us. And the Word of God says this Word that God made the world, the Logos, who God created everything through, became a real man, a real person, somebody that you can grab, touch, hold, feel, hug. He was the Logos. He was God, and he became flesh. And that's the uniqueness of Jesus. He's unlike anything they have ever understood. The Greeks knew about the gods that became men, like Hercules, you know, half man, half God, but Jesus was God fully, and man fully, 100% both at the same time. Amazing. But it was through Jesus whom he created everything. It was the Word of God. So God spoke, it was Jesus who created everything. And so we'll go back to Hebrews. Hebrews says it was through him he created everything. One interesting study you could do, I'll leave that on your own, we just don't have the time to do it here, is to take John 1 and Hebrews 1 and compare them. How they go hand in hand with each other. Jesus is the glory of God, the express image of God, the glory of God. And yet John 1 tells us the same thing. He was God's light to the world. Very interesting. We'll get to another study on its own. But he is the living Word. He is the Logos, the living Word. And so you can have the Old Testament, the writer of Hebrews is saying. You can have the Old Testament. You can read it. But unless you have the living Word in and through you, regenerated you, then you can only read about it. You haven't experienced it yet. And that's the thing with the second and third generation of believers, children of believers, or grandparents or grandkids of believers. They also need to not just hear the word, they need to be regenerated. They need to experience the salvation that is in Jesus Christ on their own, faith in him. We can pray for them, we can encourage them, we can give them the scriptures. But they themselves have to respond to the conviction of the Holy Spirit. That's what's so salvation is an amazing thing. Salvation is unique to you, unique to them. Why? Because every one of us has to be born again. Otherwise, we'll not see the kingdom of heaven. And so the second and third generation of believers had to be born again. They can't rely on the fact that they had the Old Testament. Hey, we have it. It's right here. But what is it about? Unless you have the living word. The living word is what you need. You have the Old Testament. What does it mean? Unless you have Christ, unless you have the living word in and through you. Now, he goes on, and he says in verse 3, he's the radiance of his glory. The radiance of his glory. Jesus is the radiance of God's glory. He's to reveal God's glory. I'll give you some examples. What does the next slide look like, Brother Dwight? There it is. We know that he's greater than the high priest. We know he's greater than all these things that Jesus reveals. He reveals God's glory. We'll start at the bottom. He reveals God's glory. You know, there's passages in the Old Testament, many, many, Ezekiel especially. Ezekiel chapter 1, Ezekiel chapter 3, 10, 43. All of them reveal or tell you the glory of God. They tell you about the glory of God, how majestic is the glory of God. But you know what? All of them tell you about it. Jesus is the glory of God. He is the express image of the glory of God. He reveals the glory of God. Hebrews tells us right there that he's the radiance of his glory. The writer's telling, don't just read about it. Know him. It's one thing to read it, but what about knowing the glory of God? The knowing him who's the radiance of his glory. It tells us that he's God's power. Look at about God's power. The exact expression of his nature. He sustains all things by his powerful word. What is the power? Well, I can tell you all these scriptures about God's power. Jeremiah 10, 27, 32, where God says to Jeremiah, Jeremiah, is there anything too hard for me? Nothing is too hard for me. Imagine God's power. And yet we read about it, but Jesus is God's power. He is the expression of his power. He's also the expression of his nature. How is God? How is it about God? We read in Isaiah chapter 1, chapter 6, chapter 14, and many of them. I'm just giving some passages. There's many passages. The Old Testament says God is full of compassion, merciful, slow to anger, willing to forgive. You know, that's repeated, I believe it's 7 or 8 times in the Old Testament, that very passage, that God is slow to anger, willing to forgive, merciful, compassionate, repeated all times in the Old Testament. That's God's nature. The Old Testament tells us about God's nature. But you read Jesus and then you could see God's nature. He expresses his nature to you in such a way that you could, oh, that's what God is like. And how many of us were born again? How many of us have experienced that? Not just reading it and going, oh, there it is. He's very merciful and compassionate. Okay, that's true. But have you experienced it? Have you experienced it, a forgiveness of sin, the removal of the guilt and the shame and that which we did in sin? Jesus has come, and as the nature of God is to be merciful and compassionate, he forgave you. And you now experience and living that forgiveness and experience that compassion and the removal of your guilt and shame. Only Jesus can do that. And that's what he's trying to tell you. It's one thing to have it written down. What do you do with it if he's not living in you? If you don't know him, if you have only relegated him to, and this is what the other part is. By the way, he's greater than the priest. Look what it says here. After making purifications for sin, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. He made atonement for sin. He did it. The priests were still doing it, right? In the temple, they were still sacrificing, etc. And he comes, Jesus, and he died on the cross. He made atonement for sin once and for all. Done. Over. He's greater than the priest because now he's done it all. He's finished it. Complete. Tetelestai. Paid in full. You don't need to go to the high priest anymore. You don't need to have the blood sprinkled upon you by the blood of bulls and goats. You don't need it anymore. So why are you going back? Why are you going back? Why do you relegate Jesus to some high priest that's just going to sprinkle blood on you when he has really atoned for our sin and he sat down at the majesty on high? He sat down next to God. He sat down next to God in his supremacy and his uniqueness. He has done it all. But if you compromise, if you relegate Jesus to something different than that, then his work on the cross is negated by your compromise. Meaning on you. The work on the cross, you reject Jesus as being God. You reject Jesus as being who he is, the supreme God that he is. Then that work on the cross is meaningless. Because now who is it that died for you? Verse 4. So he became higher rank than angels. That's very interesting. The supremacy of Christ, according to the book of Hebrews, is that they were relegated into an angel. Now that doesn't happen now, does it? Well, the Jews were very keen on angels. They thought the angels were some of them believed that they were the mediators of the old covenant, that they were Moses and appeared in the Old Testament. So they're very, very important. And you see them in the Old Testament. That's not Jesus. Jesus is not an angel. He's not created. He's the creator. And so he tells them, look, he's higher than the angels. He's superior than the angels, verse 5, because the angels never had God tell them, you are my son. This is quoted from Psalm 2, by the way. Psalm 2. Let's go there very quickly. We have a few minutes to go. And I love to talk about this psalm because this psalm is one of the greatest witnessing tools you can use, but also reveals the times in which we live in, the times in which we live in today. Psalm 2, verse 1, why do the nations rage and the people plot a vain thing? The kings of the earth take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed one. I love those two verses because it explains to me what's going on in the world today. Why do the nations rage? Why are nations fighting each other? And why are they conspiring to throw off God and his Messiah, his anointed? Did you know this is true? That before this century, this last century, not all the nations can gather together and conspire the way they're doing it now. It's called the United Nations. It's called the UN. It's called many different things now. Where you have nations collaborating together. On what? Religion? Yep. That's a big topic. And Israel, that's a big topic too. But all the nations conspire, and then they're still raging against each other. What do you see it on the news? Rage here, you know, protest here, attack here. Why? It's happening. The end of the age is approaching. And you see the end of the age by the nations raging against the Lord. And it goes on to verse 7. This is where I wanted to get to. Verse 7 says, I will declare the Lord's decree. He said to me, so this is the Messiah speaking, you are my son. Today I have begotten you, or I have become your father. He's speaking of the fact that the Messiah, it's God speaking to the Messiah, that he is going to become his son. He's going to be his son. And it's so unique, the fact that the book of Hebrews is quoting this to show us that no angel ever was told that. No angel ever had that title, God's unique son, begotten son. God's unique son, meaning that there's nobody like Jesus. He is unique title, and that tells you right there in Psalm 2 that he is unique above all angels. He also tells us, I will be his father, and he will be my son. Verse 6, and he again brings the firstborn into the world. He says, all of God's angels must worship him. God tells the angels, worship Jesus. Now, God must be really confused, because now he's just directed worship that is due to him to another being. Now, think about this. It's a logical sense. God tells angels to worship Jesus. Now, Jesus must be some very, very high, powerful being, because God is taking away the worship that's truly his and giving it to another person. If he's an angel, that's blasphemy. One angel tried to do that. One angel tried to take the worship of God to himself. It's called Lucifer. He's called Lucifer. And it didn't work out. Here's God saying, all the angels, worship my son. He's unique. He's high above everything. He is the Son of God. Let's keep going. And about the angels, he says, he makes his angels and servants a fiery flame. But for the Son, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of your kingdom is a scepter of justice. You are loved. You love righteousness and hated lawlessness. This is why God, your God, has anointed you rather than your companions with the oil of joy. This is quoting from Psalm 45. This is quoting from Psalm 110. These are Old Testament, rich Old Testament quotes. Why is he giving him so many Old Testament passages? It's because they knew the Old Testament. That was the original Bible, by the way. They were steeped in it. They knew it. And he's telling them something here that you might miss it. It's the fact that this is not new. It was always in God's word. Okay, he's not bringing some new revelation, like, oh, I'm going to tell you something really new. It's never been seen before. He's explaining something that God has already put in there. All he's doing is bringing it out and saying, look, it's all there. It's all here. Do you see how powerful and amazing Jesus is? Do you see how supreme he is? Do you see how above everything he truly is? So don't compromise, because you worship someone that's so great that you would be foolish to go to the temple. You'd be foolish to go and go back to that system and try to duplicate what Jesus has done already for you. And how foolish it is for Christians to amalgamate or to put Jesus and lump him into our society and just say, well, he's just one of many choices. Or yeah, my grandpa believed it, but I kind of know more about my grandpa than my grandpa. I went to Bible college, and they told me he wasn't God, that he was just some kind of being. And I know more than he does now, because we have more books and more knowledge now. Oh, how foolish. Foolish we become that we have the scriptures, and it tells us, and then we go in and say, no, he's not. Oh, this is probably what the writer of Hebrews felt. There's a heresy. I told you in the early church that Jesus wasn't God, that he was. They actually have songs. I have we did some research on it. They had a song about Jesus. This is the early heresies. They had a song about Jesus where it says, and I don't know how they sang it, because we don't have a recording of that, but basically one of the lyrics goes, there was a time where he didn't exist. and they would sing this chorus. There was a time when he didn't exist. I don't know how it went. But they would sing it. This is early heretics in the church that would sing that Jesus, at one point in the life of Jesus, who he is, Son of God, he did not exist. Now, that's not true. He's always existed. He came into being. He came into a man in Bethlehem, but he's always was. But there were heretics in the church who say, no, he was, at one point, he didn't exist. God created him. And so the Jews, the second or third generation believers, would be confused and go, well, yeah, maybe he's just an angel. Maybe he's just a prophet. Maybe he's just a very good man. Maybe we'll even admit that he's the Messiah. But that's it. He's not God. Because if he's God, then we have to worship him, and there's no need for the temple. And see, the pressure was to go back to the temple and to compromise. And it says in verse 14, aren't angels ministering spirits sent out to serve those who are going to inherit salvation? Yeah. The angels are simply servants. Servants of you. Did you know that? Angels are servants of you, those who aren't going to inherit salvation. Jesus is not an angel. He's far above the angels. He's far above anything you'll ever imagine. He's far above anything. He's the creator. And the temptation was to go back. Let's go to the next slide. How can we deny this? It's so clear. It's so really true. That Jesus is truly supreme above everything else that we can ever imagine. There's a passage in the New Testament, I believe it's in the book of John, where it says that only the Son knows the Father, and only the Father knows the Son. And you read it and you go, oh, that's really interesting, that's cool. But think of the implication of what that means. It really means that only God can truly know Jesus. Only God can truly know the fullness of Jesus Christ. That's how amazing Jesus is. It's truly amazing. He's such an amazing person that only God can truly know him. Only God can fully know Jesus of Nazareth. I mean, what kind of a being would be so amazing that God literally says, I'm the only one that can know. You're so profound. You're so amazing that it takes the eternal God and his wisdom and knowledge to know Jesus Christ fully. It has to be God. He has to be God. He has to be above angels, above priests, above anything you could imagine, above religion, about anything. He is above it all. If he is above it all, and we agree on it, then isn't he worthy of our praise, of our worship, of our honor, of our commitment, of our faithfulness, of our love, of our obedience, of our daily devotion to him? He's not a religion. He's not even some spiritual guru guy. He's not even just somebody that we visit once in a while to get good ideas from. He's God, my friend. He's God. And next week when we read it, you're going to be, knowing that, next week we're going to read about the humanity of Jesus and why he became a man. He became a man not only to atone for our sins, but also to become our high priest, to suffer in obedience to God, and also to become our high priest so he can be sympathetic to you and me. He can have not only love for us, but he can understand what we go through, and to come alongside of us and to help us in our weakness. This is God. This is the one we talked about. Above the angels, above the prophets, above anything, so far as God saying, let me move out of the way so you can sit next to me. And that God, Jesus, comes down to earth, puts on a human body, lives as a man in obedience to God, sacrifices himself, atones for our sins, loves us to the end, and he now says, I'm interceding for you. I'm walking with you. Let me live my life through you. And you'll make it. And when we fall and when we have weaknesses, I'll come alongside you like a high priest and help you in your weaknesses, help you in your temptations. Because I was tempted like that. And he didn't sin. And so he can mediate between us and God because we have a high priest. What a wonderful thing. Sometimes we'll talk about it next week. Sometimes we don't understand how profound it is to have a high priest. One who can know us so intimately and can know God so intimately. Because he himself is both God and man. He knows how to be both. That's how awesome Jesus is. He's awesome enough for God to say, I'm the only one that can know you, Jesus. Awesome. God. And he's awesome enough to come to us and says, I know what it's like to be Brad, and to be Rob, and to be Susie, and to have those weaknesses. He never sinned, but he comes alongside of us and says, I'll help you in your testing. I'll help you in your trials. And if you sin, come to me, and I'll cleanse you. I'll get rid of that sin. Let me live my life for you. That's what Jesus does for us. So why the hesitation? Why the inclination to put Jesus among all the pantheon of gods? Well, it's because we don't know who he is. It's because we forget who he truly is. And to the second or third generation of Christians, it has to be emphasized to such degree that they don't make the same mistakes as the Hebrew Christians did in the early centuries, that they were tempted to go back. Don't go back. If you're tempted to go back to something, it's not worth it. What can you compare Jesus to? And that's why I put this. Jesus is greater than? Fill in the blank. Whatever it is you have, whatever it is you want to put there, he's greater than that. And if you spend more time on that other side than on this side, then although we may acknowledge who Jesus is, we don't truly walk in that sense of awe and knowing who Jesus really, really is. Let's pray. Father, we're thankful that your grace, Lord, is so sufficient. It's amazing. Lord, we can breathe, Lord God, much easier knowing, Lord, that you are our high priest. And Lord, I thank you that being our high priest also means, Lord God, that you know me. Despite knowing me this well, you still come, Lord, to my aid and come to my rescue when I fall into sin, when I can't get up, Lord God, you are high priest. So, Lord, our obedience, our devotion is what we need to give you, Lord. Thank you, Lord God, that you are God. And above all things, Lord, you're greater than all those things that we can ever get involved in, Lord. So please, Lord, direct our hearts to you this holiday season, this Christmas season. Lord, you're greater than all. You're greater than what we've made Christmas to be. You're greater than that. And so, Lord, help us to shine that to a dying world that needs to know that Jesus is above it all. Oh, Father, thank you that you give us this revelation. You give us this truth that we're now to live on it and walk by faith. Thank you, Father God, that you did not leave us orphans. You give us your Holy Spirit to make this possible, to make this real in our lives. Jesus, please, by your Holy Spirit, make it real to us. Help us to minister to people that are in those, maybe in that crux, in that point where they can go either way. Lord, help us to remind them that Jesus is supreme, that Jesus is greater. And Lord, if we have children or grandchildren who are second, third generation from a heritage that they have, Lord, bring them back. Help them to know Jesus as Savior. Help them to know that Jesus is supreme over whatever they're doing. And help them not depart, Lord, in compromise. Thank you, Lord, that this Christmas we can say Jesus is supreme. And in his name we pray. Let's stand before the Lord, and knowing who he is, let's give an honor and worship to God.